Has Jamie eaten anything today?
She had some soup.
Some soup?
Yep.
Is there like soup on the stove? Did you make soup?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Great. Sounds good. So she's already eaten.
She had some. She didn't have a lot, but.
Okay. Junipero, ¿tú quieres comer la cena con mamá? Tricia. Vamos a sentarnos en la casa, ¿ok? ¿Vamos a la casa? ¿No quieres comer conmigo? When did she eat?
Just right now. Jay, are you there? Whatever is more comfortable for you.
No, if this sounds good, this totally works. Cool.
Perfect. Sounds great.
Hope that my connection's working out okay. We have up in the hills in Conway here, so we just got a new router last week, and it's been a little better.
Great.
But yeah, that should all be good. Cool.
Great. Let me make you a co-host right now, so I don't forget that. Make co-host. Okay. And so then, you know, I don't know how familiar you are with Zoom, but there's the share button at the bottom to share your screen. And if you want to, you know, I don't know if you have slides at all.
Yeah. Yep. I've got a PowerPoint up, so that, that works, cause I can do that. And I can just select I'll do it right now just to be sure it works, even though I've done it a bunch of times. So is that coming? Do you get a little inset of me, or am I totally off screen when I'm presenting?
No, you'll still stay at the top for the viewers.
Okay, cool.
They'll have the presentation and then the thumbnails, two or three pictures at the top, but you'll be there.
Okay, great. That's okay. Great. Okay. I'll stop sharing.
Okay. And I'll right at 7 o'clock. I will disable the wait room. And so then just everyone that's waiting comes in, and then anyone else that joins throughout the workshop will just automatically enter. We don't have to let people in manually.
Cool.
And then I'll go into a screen share, and I have 5 introduction slides.
Yeah.
It'll take less than 5 minutes to go over.
Sure.
Then I'll just stop sharing my screen after that, and then you'll be able to start sharing yours.
Okay, cool. That sounds great.
I don't know. I looked in a little more about the poll.
Yeah.
I don't know that we have that capability. I think that had to be set up before this call was actually scheduled. It had to be in the back end.
Yeah.
And I know we discussed it, but I don't think we ended up doing it just for simplicity.
Sure. No, that's totally fine. And so I basically, you know, I've got any of the couple of polls on a slide. And so I figured people can just kind of chime in via the chat, what option or options fit them. And you know, if there's a ton of people, it'll just kind of be a scattering of responses, and we won't get tallies or numbers, but
it just kills for me you to talk at hear the conversation. Yeah,
exactly. Well, and you know, just to hear back from people, like it kills me just to talk at people for an hour.
Yeah, no, so, that sounds great.
Yeah.
And so you can kind of set the chat up so you can see it or not see it, you know,
yeah.
So you'll, I'll monitor the chat as well, but you can, you know, especially when you ask those polls, definitely check it.
Okay.
And then for questions, you know, do you want people to kind of ask questions throughout the presentation or save them for the end?
Yeah, you know, it's, boy, in person, I really love it when people are able to ask it in the middle. Okay. You know, like so I'd say if somebody asks something, I'll have the chat up, but also if, you know, if, is that part of what you do is monitor the chat and sort of.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. So and that's part of my instructions as the introduction is just use the chat, how to mute, unmute yourself.
Okay.
So I will encourage people to use the chat and then I'll kind of monitor that. And if you're saying something and there's a question directly relevant to it, I might, you know, jump in and ask that question. Otherwise I'll just kind of monitor things and in case you're not able to as closely.
Okay, perfect. No, that sounds great. And I've, you know, in theory, allowed time at the end for questions, which obviously I want to make sure to do. It's this presentation itself is a relatively new one. It's the first time we've done this exact like topic. So, you know, part of me is a little worried I packed too many slides in. So what I'm going to do is try to watch the time and make sure that I leave, you know, good at least 10 or 15 minutes, depending on people and who's here and everything. So yeah, cause you know, I say right in there that, I can offer a PDF of this to anybody who wants it. So I, you know, it's, you know how it goes. Just sort of making sure I have enough, but worried I have too much.
Yeah. And this will be, this is being recorded. And so people will have access to it after the fact as well.
Yeah. Okay.
No, I'm perfect. Just trying to situate myself here on the shade sunline so I don't have it right in my eyes.
But
I don't look too goofy. So.
Yeah, where are you?
I'm at my house. I live right outside of Worcester in Paxton.
Oh,
nice.
Cool.
But the inside's a little noisy and distracting. So
Right. I know. My wife went somewhere today and or this evening and took our little dog, so at least there won't be a yappy
No problem. We're an informal bunch around here. That's part of our
exactly.
Have you presented at NOFA before?
Yeah, I did 2 years ago, two summers ago. So it was nice. You know, just at Hampshire, obviously. But yeah, no, I'm really glad that it sort of was able to pivot to be remote and, you know, that taking the opportunity to spread it out. It seems like kind of leaning into what advantages there can be when doing it remote. It just makes sense.
Yeah, no, it's all sort of reinventing the wheel here from scratch and just trying to try new ideas and see what works. And, you know, I think we've been pleasantly surprised with the amount of participants and just the lack of technical issues so far. And
sure.
You know, things have been going very smoothly and had a lot of good feedback.
Yeah, that's great. Speaking of which, I'm going to plug in my computer. The battery is...
Sure. Yeah, so we've got 10 minutes here. You know, I think we're all set. So I might just mute you here and check in and I'll be back a few minutes beforehand.
Sure. No, that sounds great. Thanks.
Great. All right. Well, we have good weather here tonight. You know, if there were an internet connection issue as a co-host, you know, if I were to drop out, you'll still carry the line. And if you were to drop out for some reason, I will still be here as well. So
okay.
You'd be able to just, you know, try and log back in and pick up where we left off.
Okay, great.
No, haven't had that happen yet.
Right. Yeah, knock on wood. Oh, that's cool.
All right, we have two people in the waiting room thus far. That's
yeah, I just saw that. That's cool. You can see them. I'd be curious to see if I recognize any names. Mm. Oh, Allison Perry. Yep. Cool.
All right. Whoops, I did not mean to do that. Unlocked, okay. Was just making sure I knew where the disable or enable wait room is.
Oh, gotcha.
All good. You gonna talk about land for good at all?
Yeah, yep, I'll sort of give our spiel, our elevator pitch, which we always joke takes a couple rides up and down the elevator, but
a pickup truck ride pitch.
Yeah, exactly. yeah, but no, it's always nice to sort of get that opportunity to connect with new folks and
definitely.
How long have you been doing stuff with NOFA for?
I've been a volunteer with NOFA on the board for probably 7 or 6 or 7 or 8 years now. Nice. And just kind of been doing, you know, different things, helping out with the summer conference, always sort of volunteered. And then the last person who'd been helping organize it had kind of decided to move on. So I've been kind of working with the summer conference now. This is my second year.
Sure.
But yeah, no, it's always been, you know, a good group of folks, you know, good people to spend time with.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. No, I had a blast when I did it before. So that's great.
Yeah. Yeah. We always, you know, we're wondering about the winter conference, obviously, you know, the winter conference is in Worcester for us in January. And, you know, who knows what to expect for that. But, you know, I think planning is already underway, you know, anticipating it might be a similar format. So
sure. That makes sense.
We shall see.
Yeah. Well, it's nice to kind of have this trial run and to know this can always be a plan B if it turns into a plan A. But I'm glad it's been working smoothly so far.
Yeah. Thank you. So we have 1 minute till 7 o'clock. Once I do share my screen, I'll wait, you know, 30 seconds, 45 seconds, a minute, just to make sure that everyone's landed, you know, from the weight room before I actually start speaking. So just have a little dead air as people get settled.
Okay, great.
Okay, well, look forward to your presentation. Have fun.
Yeah, thanks. Appreciate it.
All right, I'm going to get rid of the waiting room. We'll admit people and we'll get underway. Good evening, everyone. My name is Paul Bertler, and I am your host for tonight. I am a NOFA Massachusetts volunteer, a board member, and our summer conference operations coordinator. Thank you for attending tonight. You are attending the Farm Succession as a Pathway for Beginning Farmers with Jae Silverman. Before we get started, I have a few reminders to go over. We have a number of sponsors who help make our conference possible, and I encourage you to support them whenever you are able to. And if you are able to support them, let them know, hey, I appreciate the fact that you support NOFA Mass. I also want to thank our viewers and our listeners, you obviously, especially those of you who are members of one of your NOFA state chapters. All of the NOFAs rely on our membership to remain healthy and viable and to help support our education and advocacy work. As a reminder for the summer conference, we also have an online vendor marketplace. So many of the vendors that you see listed here, as well as the ones that you're used to seeing every summer at the actual conference, have an online marketplace, and that can be found in the program book. We want to make sure every effort to get all of your questions answered during the workshop. Jae has said that he will take questions during the presentation as possible. So we encourage you to use the comments section or the chat section. There may also be opportunities for you to ask questions depending on how many participants we have. The account is set to mute participants upon entry. To speak, simply press the microphone icon at the bottom of the screen. Please mute yourself when you are done speaking to avoid background noise. And please note that this session is being recorded. We are presenting, attending, and hosting this workshop from land that was managed and inhabited before European colonization. Please take a moment to find your location on the map and honor those whose land you now occupy. For those viewing this from outside New England, this interactive map can be found at native-land.ca, and I encourage you to check it out. And now, distinguished guests, I am excited to introduce Jae. Jae has been a presenter with the Summer Conference in years past and works with Land for Good. We are excited to have you and look forward to hearing what you have to say. So please take it away.
Great. Thanks. No, thanks for having me. And thanks to everyone who's joined so far. Well, let's see. Start by sharing my screen. All right. There we go. So yeah, doing this full remote here, just changing things so I can see the chat window. Okay. There we go. Alrighty, so thanks for joining us. My name is Jae Silverman. So I am with Land for Good. And yeah, we're here to talk about basically farm succession as a pathway for beginning farmers. So curious to hear a little bit from each of you as we get into this about where you are in that and how this might apply. So Land for Good, we're a nonprofit in New England. We work in all six New England states. And we basically work on issues of farmland access, tenure, and succession. So I'm the Massachusetts field agent. I cover Massachusetts. I work from home, as you guys can see here. And I really, you know, do a lot of one-on-one work with farmers, landowners, and farm seekers. So really the folks we work with, we can kind of break it into three major buckets. We work with farming landowners, so folks that are actively farming, they own land or own their own farm. And that's often where we do a lot of our succession planning work, is engaging with kind of the senior generation or perhaps a younger generation coming in to take over a farm. But we also work with farm seekers, and that basically is anybody looking to get on their first piece of land, whether that's purchasing, whether it's leasing, or whether it's you know, really even just trying to get a written lease for a piece of land they've been on for quite a bit of time, anybody looking to improve their overall tenure. And then on the flip side of that, we work with non-farming landowners. So folks that own farmland, I would say it can be anything from an acre along with their house that they want to see farmed by somebody, all the way up to people that inherit a full farm but aren't farmers themselves. Sometimes those folks live on the land, sometimes they don't. And you know, usually it's a matter of trying to help find a farmer, figure out what arrangements can work. Again, a lot of leasing agreements come into play there. And certainly that includes you know, public land, institutions, that sort of thing, as well as private landowners. A little bit about myself. So I'm a hay farmer in Conway, Massachusetts. I've been haying for myself, I guess this is my ninth season. It's what I was doing right before this. So I appreciated the timing of everything. It's been quite a haying season so far. So I've been with Land for Good for about 3 years now. And, you know, kind of part of my path of that was experiencing all three of those buckets I just mentioned. You know, I'm a first generation farmer myself. I've started my farm in 2012 and kind of built the business up from scratch, but I did grow up working for another farmer in town, and sort of over time he's kicked equipment and fields and customers and stuff my way. And I farm entirely on rented land. So it's really, I'm working with those non-farming landowners that have hay fields or full farms that they're not using, and allow me to have lease agreements and sort of build my business that way. So it's been really fun to do work with Land for Good and sort of tap into my own experiences, but also learn a lot of unique situations from other farmers and landowners out there. Yeah. So sort of what I'm hoping to cover today is to really kind of tap into this idea of being a beginning farmer, a farm seeker, and thinking about succession as a pathway to farm ownership. And we'll talk a little bit about what farm ownership actually means and can mean, different facets of that. And so, yeah, I'll talk about some pros and cons of being a successor for a farm, even what a successor means, you know, path to the farm ownership, facets of succession planning that certainly apply to this as a younger generation or a successor, and ways to sort of engage with senior generation in the family or somebody not related that you're potentially going to take a farm over from. We'll talk a bit about financial considerations that go into the idea of not only starting a farm, but taking over an existing farm. And then lastly, I'm assuming we'll have time, we'll talk a bit about sort of farm search strategies. And you know, some of that can apply to just general farm searches, but also as it applies to looking for farm opportunities to sort of step into and eventually potentially take over. And I certainly do want to say that, you know, I'm always happy to provide a PDF of the presentation. So don't feel like you have to scramble or write down notes unless it's helpful to you. And of course, it's being recorded too. So, So really kind of the purpose of this overall presentation is to sort of try to think outside the box a little bit and, you know, help you as a prospective farm seeker or beginning farmer figure out if succession is a possible fit for your farm needs. So sort of curious to do what I can interactively here. And we do have the group chat going. It looks like we've got a group size that's conducive to it. So I was just, if you can type in the chat, I've got a couple of these that pop up. The slides are blue, so if you're keyed into that. But I'm just kind of curious to know who's here and sort of what category or categories you feel like you fit into. You know, certainly we've got younger generation on a family farm. So if your family is farming and you're a younger generation, you know, that certainly applies to you. Likewise, if you work on or know of a non-family farm that you could be a successor for, you know, whether you're working for them, whether it's something that's been discussed, whether it's something you're even just hoping for. And then likewise, if, you know, you kind of feel like you're in this farm seeker, beginning farmer category, and if you're in the process of starting your own business, maybe that's already started, maybe you've already started farming, or maybe you're not quite sure where to start. And then, of course, want to be inclusive to folks that are joining this conversation who are already actively farming, already have an established farm, or even folks of a potential senior generation, you know, looking toward eventual retirement and joining this conversation as part of that. So if you can type in the chat sort of which of these categories applies to you, we'll sort of kind of get a snapshot of who's here. Let's see. We've got an active farmer looking toward eventual retirement. Great. We've got a gardener, potential farm, future farm seeker. A farm seeker looking to have a farm as part of a community center organization. That's great. And a possible success for a non-family farm. Cool. Great. Well, we've got a nice smattering here. That's great. Thanks for sharing that. So, you know, as we sort of all think about our farming ventures, and again, this can apply to, you know, whether you already have your own farm business going, you know, we all tend to kind of get this this narrative in our head of what our dream farm is. And maybe that's, it feels directly attainable. You know what your dream farm is and you know, you're already in the process of building it. Or, you know, maybe this feels like a pipe dream. But sort of one aspect of this that I wanted to hone in on. Oh, we had somebody else that chimed in too saying, let's see, casually farm seeking. I think you guys can all see the chat pretty well. So I guess maybe I won't read that, but that's great. Thanks for weighing in on that. Yeah, but sort of thinking about this dream farm and trying to unpack, you know, especially if you haven't started building it yet, you know, pretty representative of how New England is looking. And this is actually based on the 2012 census data. There's new census data, new charts and stuff are being crunched, but the story is much the same. Is that, you know, over the next 10 plus years, we've got a third of farmers that are looking to exit farming. You know, whether that means full on retirement, whether it means kind of taking a step back and getting another generation up, you know, in the driver's seat, so to speak, but really looking at a lot of acres and a lot of assets that are going to change hands over the next 10 years. And, you know, even since this report's happened, we've been watching that happen. You know, of them, according to the 2012 census, many of them don't have a younger operator working alongside them. So, you know, this idea of mentorship, of passing the farm on to somebody who's actively working in the farm, is not nearly as common as sort of the idyllic farm dream that, you know, the lifestyle that's sort of been painted over the years. It's not as common as you think. And so that really kind of creates this challenge in terms of farmland changing hands and not necessarily having a great overall plan for how that transition is going to happen. But it's also a heck of an opportunity for people that are looking to get into farming and, you know, are curious about looking at farm succession and farm transfer as a way to get into farming themselves. And this can sort of, you know, in our work with Land for Good, we work with a heck of a lot of, you know, like I said, with farm seekers and landowners. And you can kind of see this business cycle play out in a number of different ways. And one of which is sort of in acreage and production. So you look at how, with this graph, you've got total farm assets. And in a business life cycle over time, you know, especially if you're starting a business from scratch, assets tends to increase. And then you kind of get to a point in the business where you look towards retirement, you look towards scaling back. And without a successor, things can kind of stagnate and start to drop off slightly. And this can be extrapolated, like I said, to acreage as well. So one thing that we've seen with Land for Good is a lot of exiting farmers that, you know, have a sizable acreage base from their business, whether it's part-time, whether it's full-time, you know, not discriminating based on size there. But then, you know, you can, if you were to repeat this graph, you have somebody new coming in that's starting with much less acreage, much less assets. And it's hard to kind of plug people into these existing farms that are, you know, available, but perhaps at a much larger scale than somebody who's looking to get into farming and starting up from a small point. So, you know, it's just sort of interesting to think about how business life cycles can work and how succession can help that business continue to grow. Obviously, you know, there's some gaps in this. Infinite growth isn't possible, as we know. There's a lot of kind of capitalistic undertones here. But the idea of at least, you know, allowing a business to maintain and not kind of keep starting over from scratch is a factor to be thinking about. Okay, great. So I was hoping to utilize the chat a little bit here and have people kind of, I guess we'll start with advantages right now. You know, I'm kind of curious to hear both. But if people can just kind of, you know, they say popcorn style, I guess is now how we describe this, but throw in the chat, you know, any advantages you can think of, whether it's for your own situation or just in general, to taking over an existing farm, to, you know, kind of getting in that succession pipeline and eventually taking over ownership of a farm that's already up and running. Great, we've got existing customers, absolutely. Infrastructure and knowledge passed down. Yep, that's great. You guys are hitting this right on the head. Anybody else? It's hard to know if someone's typing. I'll give you guys a little bit of time. Zoning. Yep. So sort of having a sense of what's conducive to what, both legally, but I can kind of extrapolate that too to what the land is suitable for. That's great. Yep. Profit and loss, income statement, knowing sort of what the financial state of that business is. Definitely. This is great. Feel free to keep dropping them in there if I'm missing anybody. But yeah, that's exactly it. I mean, really, you're walking into a business that's already established. It presumably already has markets that exist. And, you know, there's not as many hypotheticals about what sort of market it can sustain, what kind of customer base. I mean, obviously, this year has been quite a year to show everybody that our best guesses can get thrown out the window pretty quickly, both positively and negatively. And, you know, it's important to recognize that it's already at a scale. It doesn't necessarily mean it's the scale or the right scale or the right scale for you, but it's already in motion. You know, somebody mentioned mentorship. That's a huge piece of it too, is actually learning from somebody who's been doing it, potentially been doing it on that land with those customers. And that's great. And you guys mentioned the assets, equipment, infrastructure, you know, irrigation, land improvements, that kind of thing. So that's great. Okay, how about the flip side of that? Can you guys brainstorm any disadvantages? Again, whether it's for your own situation, whether it could just sort of be hypothetically, but disadvantages in taking over an existing farm from somebody. Yep, may not have land lease with acceptable terms. And that could be whether it's from that farmer themselves, whether it's from someone that farmer's been renting from already. Degraded soil, so totally depends on the management practices of the person that's been farming it. Yep. Old farmer does not like the way the new farmer wants to operate. That's definitely one that tends to raise its head. And that can go both ways. We'll talk a little bit about that. May not have the same farming values, or land can be exhausted. Yep. So that values piece takes a lot of communication. And yeah, I mean, there can be kind of mismatches. both in terms of practices, in terms of what they want the end goal to be. Inheriting bad habits. That's, I like that one. Yeah, kind of flip side of mentorship, really. If you're not sure whether the person's been doing something the best way or not, it can be hard to know whether there should be something new tried. That's great. Hard to come in at a large scale, high learning curve for a new farmer. Absolutely. So, you know, it can be emotionally intimidating to jump in at scale. That's great. You guys are engaged. I love this. It's a new exercise doing this remotely. I'm used to doing this in a room of people, but I'm glad we have the chat here. So that's great. Yeah. So, you know, basically this idea of coming into a farm, having somebody else's vision already laid out and trying to figure out how to make that fit your own goals. And like you said, there, like you guys brainstormed, there can be some hurdles there as far as whether values don't align, whether the mentorship agreement is hard to actually come by. And, you know, words are one thing, but actions are a different thing. And let's see, you know, you sort of hinted at this too, but the financial piece of it can be really intimidating, you know, jumping in, taking this risk of both financial investment, but also time investment, especially if there's a mentorship piece. You know, things can go sideways, things can go south. You know, I'd like to think that in any situation, people are learning a heck of a lot, but if something makes the actual transition not happen, you know, both parties can feel like some time has been spent, and I hate to say wasted, but, you know, it's kind of back to the drawing board feeling. And, you know, certainly it a lot more capital is often needed, not always needed, but often needed to kind of jump in and eventually assume ownership of an existing business. So that's great. Thank you guys for participating in that. Let's see, I'm just trying to keep myself on track with time here. Great, actually we're right on track. So kind of looking at different pathways to ownership in a farm transfer is sort of what I wanted to unpack next. And a reminder too, if you have any questions about what I'm saying, definitely drop that in the chat and we'll try to sort of tackle that as they come up, or I'll leave some time at the end too, just for some sort of greater question and answer. So it's important to look at farm ownership and to recognize that that can be the land and or the business as two separate but related things. So, you know, when we talk about owning a farm, there are plenty of people that just own a business. I, you know, use myself as a case example there. I own about an acre and a half with my house. It's enough space for us to live, for us to have backyard chickens that aren't really, you know, part of the farm, and enough space to play Tetris with my hang equipment in the driveway every winter. You know, that's about it. I don't actually own any of the land that I farm. So my farm is a business entity, but is not not really tied to land other than my rental arrangements with that land. Whereas otherwise, you know, I'm sure lots of people can think of, you know, a farm that really is, it's an entity tied to the land, and you've got a, you know, a homestead with acreage that's owned by the farmer who's farming it. So yeah, just to put that out there to try to detach the two, but realize how they relate together. So kind of the simplest, part, maybe most thought of path to ownership is an outright purchase. You know, that's usually with financing. It's, when I say outright purchase, it's rare that somebody is able to afford a farm, you know, paying cash, but it does happen sometimes. And sort of, you know, nuances of this are, is it what we call a turnkey operation? In other words, is everything there ready to farm? You know, equipment, inventory, often a customer base, everything else. And they're really looking for a buyer to come in, make the transaction, and be the next farmer pretty much out of the gate. So when you hear the term turnkey, you can actually see that in some listings. And that's usually what they're talking about is this farm's ready to go. We're ready to get out. And we want somebody else to come in and essentially turn the key and you know, set the farm running. And then another piece of this, which we'll touch back in a couple times, but this idea of a life estate or a life tenancy. And it really plays in here because there are times where the current farmer wants somebody to buy, you know, wants somebody to take over the farm. They want somebody to buy the land, but they want to continue living there. And so that's where this notion of life estate or life tenancy comes in. And when that happens, there's essentially a lifelong lease agreement, more or less, from the previous farmer to the new owner, saying that they get to, you know, live out their days until they're either incapacitated or pass away. So that's a nuance that we see come up pretty commonly as people that have either built a farm up from scratch or have lived there their whole lives you know, while they're ready to exit farming, they're not necessarily ready to move. But that, you know, doesn't have to mean that they, that their farm can't be for sale either. So on the rental side of things, it's pretty common to see, or, you know, decently common. In fact, I have a friend and somebody that worked with us at Land for Good, that essentially purchased the business, but is now leasing the land from the previous owners. And, you know, they're sort of feeling that out in this particular situation about ownership in the future. But, you know, it's a viable strategy at times, especially if capital investment on the part of the incoming farmer, you know, if they don't have as much capital to put towards land purchasing. And if the exiting farmer is willing to continue owning the land and collect income from it in the form of rent, that can be a viable way to go about it, and actually even can be an intermediary step as well, for, you know, eventual land purchase. This is where we talk too about the idea of lease to own, which is something we talk about a lot in our leasing work, and you know, really lease to own kind of gets broken into those three buckets of having a right of first refusal on land, which means you get the right to purchase it if somebody else makes an offer. You get the right to match that offer. And then, you know, the other two, purchase option and rent towards purchase price, are more when the owner is agreeing they want to sell it to you and they're just talking about selling it down the road and having you rent it in the meantime. So if you have questions about lease to own, you know, I'm happy to connect about that, you know, after this or via email or anything. So a piece that we see happen a decent amount too is this idea of a gradual transfer. And oftentimes that happens through mentoring, through somebody being hired in a management position. It can work out really well as a trial period, especially if the exiting farmer is, you know, fine with waiting a while. They're not looking to hand over the reins just yet. Of course, my dog decides to roll in the background and groan just as I'm presenting. So this can be a way to sort of work your way up in a farm. But a downside to this, and something we see, and this applies to both family situations as well as non-family situations, is having the success. Oh gosh. Okay. Moose, please stop. Oh boy. Always happens. So, you know, the succession potential might not be clear in a given situation. And it could be expressed. You could talk about it. You could hear, you know, the farmer say someday, oh, this will be yours. And like I said, that's not always family related. The farmer I grew up for, you know, says that to me all the time. But timelines and things aren't clear. And so there can be, you know, frustration and muddy waters in there, you know, without kind of clear agreements in place. But it can be a way to really grow into a position and not necessarily feel like you're suddenly thrown in the deep end of needing to, you know, take over another farm this instant by any means. We see this happen over the course of a year, of a couple of years, sometimes even 10 years. And we've worked on management transfer charts to actually, in fact, I have an example at the end of ways to really work on handing over management responsibilities over that period of time. And that can sometimes lead into a business partnership, or, you know, sometimes that can happen from scratch. But this idea of the outgoing farmer and the incoming farmer, again, related or not, for a time can be business partners and can actually own shares of the business together. In fact, that can be a really good way to transfer the business over to another person, is through that the incoming person gradually purchasing shares of the business, or land, or being gifted it. So there's, you know, different mechanics that way to make this happen gradual and to actually have that timeline spelled out, of when the transition is going to happen. So it's important to say that transfers usually or often use a combination of these strategies we just talked about, you know, outright purchasing, leasing, management positions and mentoring, and business partnerships, as well as other outside the box ideas. You know, examples of that could be an incoming person starting their own business on another farmer's land and sort of, you know, having a co-op going. There people really tend to think outside the box in a lot of ways too. So sort of as a segue, a lot of times it is, especially with gradual transfer, farm succession planning can be a really important key to that. And so, you know, I would say we, with our work at Land for Good, we engage with both senior generation and younger generation, and that includes non-related younger generation folks. We engage with both groups to really lay out this whole succession planning process. And I use the word process, and it's really important to say that succession and succession planning is rarely ever an event, you know, that happens and is over and done with. And the planning process itself can sometimes take a year or two, and is usually an evolving document. You know, we try to work with people in advance of the actual succession event happening, to really allow people to have time to plan, allow the next generation time to plan. You know, like I said, with some of those gradual transfers or, you know, future transfers, implementation can take up to a decade. Yeah, and sort of, you know, a message for the senior generation, or for those of you who are, you know, younger generation or an incoming farmer working with an older farmer or active farmer. It's important to stress that while the two things of succession planning and retirement can often feel linked, and sometimes a senior farmer says they're ready to get out and they're ready to retire, for a lot, it's really hard to think about hanging up your hat as a farmer into retirement. And so doing the planning for it doesn't actually necessarily mean that it's time to retire. And, you know, a lot of times it actually allows people to enjoy their, the later stages of farming, to actually have a plan laid out. So part of what I was hoping to talk about here are some strategies, some context for those of you that are farm seekers to sort of engage with other folks on the succession planning topic. So to that end, another, blue slide, which means group participation. Just sort of, you know, curious to hear from you guys, whether it's personal experience, again, whether it's hypothetical, sort of throwing in the chat reasonings for why engaging with someone on succession planning, or, you know, if you're an active farmer yourself, why engaging with it yourself might feel difficult, or why it is difficult. And again, if that wasn't clear, that was basically this question to be thrown in the chat, but I'm assuming people are typing. And if you don't know, that's okay too. Gotcha. Okay. So the idea of not owning the land and only having a 1-year lease, so it can be hard to know what the future holds in that case. Absolutely. Stubbornness. And so farmers that refuse to succession plan because they don't want to admit they might need to stop farming. Absolutely. Trying to talk about that lifestyle change when it's all somebody knows, maybe it's you know, someone's lifelong passion, as I'm sure it is for many of us. So yeah, trying to, how do you have that conversation of looking toward the end of farming, whatever that means. Navigating ambiguity, I like that. So basically looking at, a lot of words can be said and it can be tough to know exactly what are meant by them. And a lot of, you know, again, talking about that whole adage of someday all this will be yours, but then refusing to give over any responsibilities can really be a mixed message. And I should say too, that when we talk about retirement for a farmer, it can mean a lot of different things. Usually in succession planning, we're looking toward retirement, meaning that farmer is no longer the principal decision maker on the farm, but it doesn't necessarily mean that they are not involved in the farm or not driving a tractor or in the fields or working with customers. And actually it can be pretty common to have a senior generation person hired on as an employee or as an advisor afterwards to kind of make that transition feel more smooth. Let's see. Complicated family dynamics, knowing who owns the land. Absolutely. That can be really muddy, especially if there's trusts involved that are old and hard to decipher and people aren't exactly clear on who's entitled to what. That can get really complicated. And just as much so if this is entirely a conversation within one family, or if you're somebody not related and kind of stepping into that family situation and trying to figure out how you fit and how how you can make sure your interests are protected. Absolutely. That's great. Thank you guys for that. If you have any more ideas, feel free to drop them in. So you pretty well hit on this. I mean, it's a big emotional trigger for people. It, you know, and brings up a whole slew of other mixed baggage along with it too. You know, in the family dynamic realm, we often talk about this equal versus equitable distinction. And that's, you know, they're not always the same thing, especially if you have a younger generation person that's worked on the farm and has siblings that don't. You know, there are some families that decide that the person that's committed to the farm has more, you know, more stake and more right to some of those farm assets. And, you know, another thing too is it's an easy can to kick down the road. There's other things happening on farms. Even, you know, I grow one crop, which is hay, and I still feel like I have way too many balloons in the air I'm trying to juggle. And so there's always other things to be nagging and to make it, you know, to make it feel like this is an important thing, but something that just, you know, we can't get to it right now is kind of what we hear from a lot of people. You know, the timepiece is definitely a big part of it, especially if that's tied in with procrastinating on it. Suddenly the time commitment and rush to do so can feel too intimidating and you know, you kind of get paralyzed in that process of not knowing where to start. And as we talked about before, there's a lot of risks and uncertainties, you know, both for succession that happens within a family, as well as trying to find somebody from outside the family. Unforeseen things can happen. People's attitudes can change. People can realize it's not the right fit. And so, you know, that can sort of make people hesitant to even engage in the process when they're scared about that kind of stuff. So thanks. That's great. So we talk about, you know, ways to kind of get this process going. And when we talk about who is the driver, that's really a matter of who's kind of trying to get the process going. You know, there's oftentimes that it's the senior generation or junior generation or somebody non-related. So, you know, maybe it's somebody that's not even involved in the farm, but is watching this happen and is trying to facilitate the process. But trying to figure out kind of who that driver is and how they can, you know, take on that facilitator role, or, you know, get other people involved that really need to be. And so step one is to really kind of take stock of things, actually have some meetings, whether it's a family meeting, whether it's sitting down with that farmer that you've been working for, or, you know, maybe it's a neighbor whose land you're interested in utilizing, and just trying to see where everybody is, where everybody stands. And, you know, this can really dive into things about business planning and you know, really trying to figure out who needs to be at that table to figure out these first, you know, engaging steps and conversations. So, yeah, and this can really just kind of help get that clarity that a lot of folks need. And this is oftentimes where we, you know, with Land for Good, step in and help people have these initial meetings and try to be that facilitator, that coach to the process of getting things laid out and figuring out what the next steps are. You know, it's rare that a farm can do this by themselves. And so knowing the, knowing the resources to lean on, whether it's Land for Good, whether it's other organizations, that, you know, aid in succession planning. Oftentimes there's, you know, folks need a legal team, needing accountants, business consultants, that sort of stuff, to try to make sure that various things can line up. So, you know, I see a lot of situations where people kind of feel like they need to take this on themselves and then start feeling stuck about who to turn to. And that's certainly something that we can help with as well. You know, and of course, cutting yourself slack and knowing this is going to take time and effort. It's not going to happen overnight. And you know, it's oftentimes people get most motivated to do it during the growing season, but that's usually when there's the least amount of time and energy. So it's a matter of kind of taking note and taking stock of things that need to happen and then getting them pushed off to, you know, if there happens to be an off season for a certain farm or operation or lifestyle, to try to tackle it then. Yeah. So, you know, looking at this gradual transfer process as one of the ways to do this, and it's not to say that these ideas are limited to a gradual transfer. Certainly, you know, there's negotiation that needs to take place in even a turnkey business sale, you know, but really trying to focus on tangible things that can be said. You know, I think we can all think of situations, and I certainly can, of talking with someone for hours about something, and then when it comes down to actually do it, you realize your visions don't necessarily align, because you spend a lot of time talking about, you know, qualitative things, which are important to make sure that, you know, visions align. But then when you get down on the ground, you realize you're not actually talking about the same thing. So trying to, you know, actually make needs and priorities clear and known. And then for yourself, as somebody that's interested in taking over a farm, making it really clear to yourself ahead of time, you know, what is necessary for this to work for you? You know, what's desirable? You know, something you'd like to see, but you can have some wiggle room on what things are truly optional. You could go either way on. And also, at what point is something a deal breaker? And being able to have those conversations with the other party too, or parties, to see, you know, see where they stand on those and try to have things actually clearly laid out. yeah, so everybody can be on the same page. You know, talking about visions and goals, we've talked about a good amount, but it's, you know, we've done exercises where people can write a legacy letter for their farm to really sort of help help next generation or other people, you know, who have a stake in it, to really understand where they're coming from and kind of take that time to really, you know, share what the farm means to them, you know, what directions they see it going, whether or not that's where a successor would take it. And really importantly, especially if there's a gradual transfer going on, actually drafting up an operating agreement can be really helpful. And that's something, you know, where you can work off of a rough draft and eventually kind of try to get that ironed out. But that can involve things like mentorship agreements, you know, but to actually have on paper, in similar function to what a lease does, but in relation to an, you know, a incoming farmer, a next generation, taking over a farm from an exiting farmer, and to have it actually spelled out what that sort of transfer is going to look like and how things are going to operate in the meantime. Yeah. And if, you know, if that's something that you're feeling is particularly applicable to you, feel free to reach out to me. We have some examples. We work through those sort of things with folks. And then of course, you know, it's a matter of actually maintaining good relationships with folks. You know, a lot of these are just sort of basic tenets of cooperation and working with someone, actually having taking that time to have regular meetings, even when things feel crazy, when things feel busy, trying to have those meetings actually set aside immediate logistics of the farm and actually put time toward the succession planning piece of things. And, you know, that can be a heavy lift, both if it's a family meeting or, you know, if you're an employee or a manager with a farm. And you know, if you already meet regularly to talk about what needs to happen on the farm that day or that week, that's great. But it's important to make sure you also have meetings that look at the bigger picture, look at the succession and transfer piece, try to look at your goals and your timelines and see how you're doing as a team on that. And so, you know, it actually works out well for people to have separate meetings for that sometimes. And, you know, you guys were talking about the emotional things that succession planning brings up. And it's really important as an incoming farmer to try to be patient with people as they grapple with those life changes, and you know whether they're imminent, whether they're down the road. And in the end, empathy really carries the day, and it's perfectly reasonable to ask that of them for you as well. You know, for them to recognize the risk and you know, uncertainty that you're bringing in on your end of it. And for the other party to be patient, empathize with you as well. You know, and so a lot of this can come down to conflict management, how to manage misunderstanding. And a lot of that too can start out with having really clear goals and clear agreements from the get-go. And, you know, knowing when to sort of refocus on, you know, those bits that you've already talked about, that you've already agreed upon, that you've already hopefully put in writing and, you know, in a friendly way, or even in an operating agreement. But you know, when tensions rise can be where these things can kind of go off the rails a little bit, and knowing how to recenter and have those conversations, you know, can be equally important, but also difficult. So I did want to talk a little bit too about, you know, financial readiness as it relates to farm succession too. You know, there's a lot of those dynamics that are really important drivers in this. But when it comes to being a successor for a farm, there are definitely financial considerations that, you know, you at least need to be ready to think about, ready to discuss. And then for the purposes of this presentation too, something for you to think about whether or not being a successor for an existing farm feels like it could be an okay fit for you on the financial side of things as well. So really to start with, looking at what your personal and family finance situation is like. There are lots of apps available. I know that I personally use You Need a Budget, which I keep saying is the only way I know how to adult. It's what helped us to buy our house. So really there are ways to sort of keep track of what your own personal family finance is. And why that's important is because ultimately that to know what you need from the farm and what you need from any, you know, eventual farm ownership, it all starts with knowing how your own personal finance works. And this can help you figure out whether a particular farm opportunity could fit the bill for you. And totally depends where you are in your life. If things are feeling really malleable and you're kind of early in your career, it can feel unsure, and you can maybe even be feeling ready to adapt to whatever situation you come to. Versus if you're already mid-career or you're doing a career change, you probably have very real financial considerations that you need to be really sure any farm that you step into is able to meet those finances. And this absolutely applies to part-time income as well. This is not only full-time farms we're talking about by any means. So then once you actually step into a business or are looking toward that, it's important to know how the farm's finances work. And can you have those conversations with the current owner? Or if it's more gradual transfer, or if you're an employee, do you think you can work toward a point where they can rope you in on that and actually help you understand, what the business expenses actually look like, what the farm growth trajectory looks like, whether there are capital improvements that are needed on the land. And, when all is said and done, is there enough to eventually satisfy your personal income needs as an eventual owner of that business? And coupled with that, are there any expenses with the exiting farmer? And so that could include, if you were to form a partnership for a piece of it, can the business actually support paying both of you, or allowing both of you to have an owner's draw from the business? And, as the farmer exits the farm as the principal owner, principal manager, are they still going to continue to work? Do they have that life tenancy that we talked about? And are there other carrying costs related to the outgoing farmer that the business is actually going to have to continue covering, at least for the interim? And does that work for you and your business, hopeful business plan and your own personal income needs from the farm? There's certainly times where the exiting farmer or even, family members, the farm's always paid their utility bill. And suddenly when they're not, when they're not the owners of the farm anymore, part of their life tenancy arrangement might be for them to continue having the utility bills paid for them. Or on the flip side, they might need to do their own retirement budgeting and planning to see what other funds and what other sources they can come up with to pay some of those expenses, because quite likely or quite possibly the farm can't afford to actually continue paying those expenses while supporting you as the new new owner or, co-owner or manager. So this can be a great time if time and communication allows to either write from scratch or update a business plan for the farm, and having the current farmer involved in that process can be invaluable and allow them to really pass on and get into writing and even try to get some numbers and data about their experience and a way to get a really good snapshot understanding of how the business functions right now, and then use that as a springboard to think about potentials for the future. Whether you as the successor are looking to continue the farm as it's been run, whether you're looking to do any branching off into new endeavors, retooling things, or doing a hard pivot to a different enterprise. Knowing the current state of things from the current farmer can be really important and invaluable. And, in New England, we're really lucky that we have some excellent support organizations that do business planning classes. I know in Massachusetts, we've got the Mass Department of Ag does a business planning course. We've got, New Entry Sustainable Farming Project doing business planning course, the Carrot Project. So there's some really great folks that can help get this process going rather than feeling like you need to learn how to do a business plan from scratch. So right here, we're basically talking about running the farm. So you've got your own personal finances. You've got the finances of the farm as a business entity. It's working, knowing what you need to draw from it, what expenses it's covering. And then, the last piece of that puzzle is knowing what you can actually afford on the farm acquisition side of things. And, you know, again, that's perhaps buying land. Maybe it's just buying the business. Maybe you're just buying, you know, equipment and infrastructure, but trying to make sure that you can actually afford that and that you're not actually, you know, plowing your savings into this purchase of a farm and then not having enough of a cushion to, you know, retool or scale up the business or to have a rainy day fund for your family living expenses. You know, there's stories of folks that have really put every last dime into buying the perfect farm and then realize within the first, you know, several years that they don't have the capital that they need to actually make improvements and buy new equipment and that sort of thing. And so when we talk about carrying costs of a piece of land, we really use this acronym called the Dirty Five, which is the five basic things when you own an asset, which is depreciation, interest, repairs, taxes, and insurance. With land, hopefully that's appreciation because land usually, you know, hopefully gains value rather than loses it. But when you're looking at overall farm with assets and barns and, you know, things that ultimately depreciate over time, you know, that's the basically what it costs on a yearly basis to own that. Again, whether it's a vehicle, whether it's a piece of infrastructure, whether it's a whole farm, but kind of understanding that and recognizing what you can afford to put into that. And then, you know, with renting land, there's still plenty of other expenses. I mean, if the farm business itself has already been renting the land, then hopefully that's built in as an expense, you know, in the line item each year, and you can kind of see how that's been playing out. But if you're going into a situation where the farmer owns their land and has been farming it themselves, and you're taking over their business, but you're going to rent the land from them, that potentially changes the dynamics of the business and what kind of expenses the business has, as well as, you know, in that situation, who actually, who's responsible for the maintenance and repairs and infrastructure, for example. So, you know, being clear with that and recognizing what you're comfortable with and what you're financially comfortable with is really important rather than just sort of discovering it the hard way and stumbling into it. Let's see. Yeah. So, and I guess the next piece to talk about a bit is, see what we're doing on time. Great. So in talking about farmland search stuff, and this, you know, again, can apply to both looking for something, to place to start your own business, but also, you know, as we'll talk about, places to look for succession opportunities. I'm just kind of curious to hear from folks and sort of, you know, throw it in the chat. If you have been searching for farmland, or even if, you know, if you're thinking about starting, places that you have utilized, that you've looked and seen, you've looked for properties either for sale or for rent or succession opportunities, you know, could be none of the above, in which case I'm happy to hear other things you've been working on. You know, I'm certainly through the family land piece into this too, that if you do have family land in the picture and you're looking toward that as being, you know, being either a succession or farming opportunity, certainly want to include that. So, yeah, so feel free to throw in the chat any of these that apply to you or if it's other, where else you might've been looking or utilizing. Official land links, spoke with farmers, general online real estate, absolutely. New England Farmland Finder, cool, love that. We'll talk a little bit about that. Anybody else? This is just useful for me to have as a readback to hear what strategies people are using. Haven't started yet, absolutely legitimate. Interesting topic, farming your home property. Great. So that, yeah, that counts as already identified land or opportunity. Cool. Thanks. Oh, NOFA classifieds. Yes, absolutely. That's great. So looking out is someone who's interested in farming, signing up for New England Farmland Finder or starting to peruse these things, see what's out there, which is great. I mean, I absolutely, this whole ball starts rolling and you start to think, wait a minute, am I ready for this? Do I even know what I want, what I'm looking for, what I'm prepared to move for, etc. So this is sort of a list of you know, basic questions to run through with yourself. And, you know, if you're the, if it helps you to write it down, really, but not quite realize what the ongoing effects of something like a long commute might look like. And, you know, if you are interested in this transfer pipeline, trying to figure out whether you're more interested in an immediate transfer with the other person about what your needs are on this spectrum. And so when we talk with farm seekers that are looking for land or, you know, a place to start their own business, this list of farm and